Good morning, Liberty. It's great to see you all this morning. I'd invite everyone to keep coming in and finding their seat. We're going to begin this morning with a worship song, so I'd invite you to stand up with us, and we're going to begin with Who You Say I Am. So please follow Michelle as she leads us, and let's sing together.
Would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free. Child of God, yes I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died. Yes, I am. child of God. Yes, I am.
Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you that when we trust in you, we are your children. Father, we thank you for this morning that we can be together and just commit this time to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, church. Yes, beautiful day outside, and we're glad that you're here. I'm Dane Shout, one of the pastors here at Liberty. We would like to welcome you and thank you for being here. And once again, we had our special service last week, but once again, congratulations to our graduates. We had some graduation ceremonies Friday and Saturday. We got some today, and then next week as well for those of our students. So congratulations to you. And we are going to continue to pray for you. Just a few quick announcements before we introduce you to someone that's a guest with us this morning, but has been with Liberty for actually about 30 years. Change the baby bottles that you're supposed to fill and change. Those were due last Sunday. You didn't get it here. That's fine. There's a table out in the lobby. If you brought them today, you can certainly put them on the table. And if you forgot them today, bring them to the church office, and that would be great. June 12th, you're going to want to mark it on your calendar. It is our annual Liberty Family Picnic. Typically, we do it right after our worship service. Typically, it's blazing hot, and so we've changed venue and we've changed time. This year, it's going to be June 12th at 5 o'clock p.m. We're going to do it in the early evening, and it's going to be at the Van Coten Place. And why is that? Because they have a large air-conditioned and or heated facility that we can be a part of. So thanks to the Van Cotens for opening up the shop. For the Liberty Free Family, but just mark June 12th, 5 p.m. Ladies, there's going to be a summer study for you available starting June 8th. All the information's in your bulletin. Child dedication, if you're interested in dedicating your child to the Lord, we're going to be doing that next Sunday during our service. So please contact myself or the church office if you're interested in child dedication. As I said previously, we've got a special guest here this morning, and I'm excited. Rich and Susan Turcha have served in the Czech Republic for a number of years. I actually, this is going to stun some of you. I actually graduated from seminary. Yep, I did. And Rich was there alongside for me. He sort of raised the curve, so my grades went down, but... So what? But we were also not only in seminary year, we were in a small group together. So I've known him. He's from the district. He's going to be sharing you a little bit about his story. Has a real, real close connection to the person who actually planted this church. And so he's going to share that as part of his sermon. But can you give a good old-fashioned Liberty Free welcome to Rich and Susan? Yeah. I'm going to ask them a couple of questions, and the slides will sort of relate. And of course, when you've got a mom and dad and grandma and grandpa here, the first question we got to ask is fill us in on the family. Okay. Tell us about who they are.
Okay, so until last weekend, the last time we were all together with all of our five kids was 5 years ago, but we got together just recently, which was wonderful. But until then, we would meet on Zoom. So here was our most recent before that family gathering. So on the top right is our daughter Emily. She's the oldest. She has our grandson Felix, who's on the right with Rich and myself in those pictures. He's adorable. He turned 4 on Friday. Then... Rob is on the bottom right. He's serving with Reach Global in Berlin, working with refugees. Rebecca is in the Netherlands, bottom left. So she has learned Dutch, and she is a physiotherapist there. And then Alex and Kelly were married 2 years ago, just out of college, and work both online in business. And then Dave in the middle is going to be a senior at Liberty University, and... he's an RA, he's got an internship this summer, and so that's the update on our kids. So you probably, or maybe some of you remember when we used to bring them all with us, but now they're all on their own.
You notice one picture of the child, two pictures of the grandchild. That's right. Gotta love that. That is the way it should be. So, okay, Rich, where have you been serving? How long have you been serving? What's your role with Reach Global, which is the mission agency for the Evangelical Free Church?
Yeah, just good. Thank you for your warm welcome. Thank you so much for praying for us, supporting us since you all sent us out back in 1994. Man, last millennium. So we've been serving in the Czech Republic in the area of developing pastors, starting new churches in cooperation with Czech National Free Churches. I had served as a free church pastor in Iowa here in a couple churches, and then the Lord led us to go and to serve with Reach Global in Europe. And so our ministry has been primarily in the Czech Republic, and then during the last 10 years serving in different parts of Europe in training and developing our missionaries and developing church plants. And so thinking about the topics of what is a transformational church? How do we move towards a transformational church? How do we help our staff and our national partners, whether they are accountants, whether they are school teachers, bankers, whether they're pastors part-time, how do we help them to find their place in serving in those church plants? So that's kind of our ministry that I've been doing the last 10, 15 years.
Super. Okay, the Czech Republic. Many of us may not know that very closely. In a very brief time, just what is the spiritual climate like in the Czech Republic and the other former sort of Soviet countries?
Yeah, that's a good question. Next slide, Travis, please. It gives you an idea of where in the world is the Czech Republic. And today it's called Czechia, and you can see it's off kind of, and that was used to be called Eastern Europe. Today it's more Central Europe, and you see some of the countries around them, Poland, Slovakia, Hungary, Austria, and then Ukraine. But the spiritual climate, I would describe, Dane, as I spoke with the group of young adults last night, it is one where 70% of the people in the last census would say, we are atheist. That means we're not Buddhist, we're not Muslim, we're not Christian, we just have no faith. But the thing is, when you sit down and talk with them, they are spiritually interested. So because of their history of the church oppressing people within those countries, they have a very bad flavor for the church or institutionalized Christianity. Jesus, maybe they'll have a conversation about. Church, they're a little bit standoffish. And so I would say that the culture is such that I say that I'm a Christian, I'm a believer, I teach in a Bible college or a seminary, they're like, really? That's very interesting. And they want to know more because for most Czechs, where only a half of 1% of the people would be evangelical, most Czechs have never met a Christian before.
Interesting. You see the map of Ukraine. Following our worship service, starting at 11 o'clock sharp, from 11 to 11:30, we're going to get you out of there by 11:30 if you're interested in hearing more about their ministry. And he's also going to give you a report about the Free Church, Reach Global, in the Ukraine right now and how they're serving during this time. That's going to take place in the library starting at 11 o'clock. So if you want more information about that. Susan, we're going to close. You've been in the Czech Republic for many years. What are one or two things that you enjoy the most about living in the Czech Republic? What's one or two things you enjoy the most?
Yeah, that's hard because there are so many. But, great transportation, public transportation, great bread. But I would say the best thing is the people, the people in the Czech Republic. They are just genuine, they're well-read, they know their history, they're bright, they're funny, they have a real funny sense of humor, kind of a dark sense of humor, but we enjoy that, and so, and they need Jesus, and so I have the opportunity to share my faith with them, and so that's the best thing about living there.
We're going to pray for Rich and Susan and also some other needs that are here in the Liberty body. And I've asked one of our elders, Doug Adama, to come and first pray for Rich and Susan. And then he's going to pray for some of the families. Why don't we go ahead and we're going to sing after we're done here. So why don't we go ahead and stand and let's pray for Rich, Susan, and the body. Thanks, Doug.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you for Rich and Susan for their ability to visit us again and update us on what is going on. We just pray for your Holy Spirit to work upon them as they serve you in Central Europe, in the Czech Republic, and other countries around that. Just pray that we would encourage and support them today, that you would guide and direct them as they serve, and bless the ministries, the camps, and the various things that they're doing to reach people that need you. We pray also for Andreas and Isaiah as their baby is expected this week. Just pray for your safety over this young child, and maybe you keep them in your hand. And for others that are hurting or broken, just pray that your spirit might rest upon them and lift them up and encourage them. For wayward children, that they might remember or realize the lies they've believed, and that they might remember what they have been taught and come back home. We pray for your blessing upon today. May we honor and glorify you in all that we do and say. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
My Jesus, I love you.
seated.
Very good. Again, a good morning to you all. It's good to be here. It really is. I think it has been a long time since we've been here, able to be here. And thankful for being able to meet with many of you. I think probably most of you we haven't had a chance to meet. There's been so many people who have come into Liberty over the last few years, and we haven't been back. And so after the service, would love to just say hi to you. It's okay if it's only just for a short moment. For those of you who have a moment to stay and to hear us give a little bit of update on some characteristics of Czech Republic and the situation in Ukraine, would love to meet you. Also, just wanted to thank you, or I guess say congratulations to the high school graduates, to those who are graduating from college. You know, Psalm 127 reminds us that children are a blessing from the Lord. And as my wife and I have realized, they are a blessing when they're at home, and they are a blessing when we send them out as well, right? Psalm 127 also says that like arrows in the hand of a warrior are the children of one's youth. Blessed is the man, blessed is the couple who fills his quiver with them. And we know that arrows aren't meant to stay in the quiver, but rather to be shot out, right? And so I just want to encourage this body to find those high school graduates, maybe those college graduates, and to remind them of the potential that God has for them in their next place of work, in the education that they're going to be pursuing. A reminder that God will work in them and through them. So, hats off to you high school graduates. Awesome. I was there a few years ago. In fact, wow, as I think of this picture, I think of my high school graduation, and they had a picture of the people who received the rewards, or these awards, right, from the Lions Club, from the Rotary Club, from the person who won the Home Ec Award, right, back in 1983. And so, wow, if you have good math, you'll realize that was a few years ago. But I remember seeing a picture of this one person, and he felt like he was surprised. Like, why am I getting this reward, this award? And it was the Danforth Leadership Award. And I know that he felt surprised, like, why am I getting this? Because I was that person. I had grown up in a home where both of my parents actually had passed away in a car accident when I was 5 years old. And so I grew up with siblings who loved me deeply, but at the same time, I grew up without a father who was able to give me direction, who was able to point to the potential and to say, son, these are the gifts that you have, and this is the potential that God has for you. And yet, I remember how the Lord put people in my life. He put high school teachers. He put a pastor in my life who, when I was 17, led me to Christ through a series of events, who discipled me. That pastor, actually, for those of you who have been around here for a long time, was the pastor who had founded this church back in the early 1990s, Bob Neuendorp. And so I remember people that God put in my life to invest in me, to encourage me, to see the potential. He put college professors in my life. He put elders from churches that I was involved in. He put college friends in my life. I'm just wanting to encourage you that Jeremiah 29:11 reminds us, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, to shalom you, to give you hope and a future. Just wanting to encourage you folks today as you look at those college grads, those high school grads, to ask yourself, how will I remind one of those graduates of God's real hope, of God's potential that he has for those young women and men who are going out, they're being shot out into the world like those arrows. So that's just my short greeting, kind of a short update on how the Lord has worked in my life. I look forward to opening God's Word to us from Psalm 139, but as we do that, I'd ask you to bow our heads and ask the Lord's blessing, please. Our Father in heaven, we stand before you as the one who created us. You are the one who gives us breath and life. Lord, you are the one who determined the places where we would live and where we will live and how long we'll live. And so we want to hear from you today, Father, the one who has written into words your thoughts, the things that you consider to be most important for us. So would you give us ears to hear? Would you give us, please, by your Spirit, courage to take the things that are uncomfortable to us today? Would you have the freedom, please, to change and work in our lives? This is what we ask, not because you need to listen to us, but we ask this because of Jesus, the one who has given us his righteousness, who has gone before us. Father, thank you for working through my words and my lips, and may they be pleasing to you. And may everything else just drop off. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So my wife and I, as Dane introduced us, have been serving in the Czech Republic since 1994. A lot of our work, as we described, is working with young people and 20-somethings. It's also working with pastors and churches of local churches. But one of the ways that we've found a wonderful kind of method of just developing relationships so that we can start sharing our faith with people in these cities is through sports activities, English clubs. And one summer, we even did work projects. And so we went to the town mayor of the city where we were working in a church plant, and we said, hey, we would like, if you could, give us the names of nonprofits, of schools who need some construction, they need some cleaning up in their yards. Maybe you know of some people who are low income, and we can help them. And the mayor was like, wow, you really want to help us? And we said, sure, we have lots, we don't have a lot of money, but we have some muscles. We have a team from America that's come to help us to do the work. We have some Czech students who are going to be working with us. And so that's what we did for a week. And then in the afternoons, we had this big tent kind of situated in the center of town, and we had games, we had some food, we had music at night, and just sitting around having conversations. But I remember one of the conversations that I had with one of those Czech students who were kind of, they weren't a part of our student group, but they were standing off to the side. They were watching our students work, and I said, hey, give me some feedback on what you're hearing, what you're experiencing. And the student said, you know, it's interesting, I haven't really come into contact with many Christians, but what I noticed was this, is that your students were like working, and I noticed them even kind of start to fight at one point. One person was saying, oh, we need to do it this way, and the other person, oh, no, we need to do it this way. And there was kind of a tussle that went on, and that Czech student who was just onlooking said, yeah, and I just kind of realized that they were kind of mad at each other and angry, and it didn't look so good. But then that Czech student went on to say, but I noticed this. After a little while, one of them said, oh, I am so sorry. You're right. It's not a big deal. We can do it your way. And I'm so sorry for the words that I said to you. And that Czech student who was looking on was like, wow, I don't think I'd ever experienced that before. Of somebody like apologizing, saying I'm sorry, and saying I think we need to do it your way. What was it that student was observing? What was it that was so attractive to them as they saw these people kind of fighting and having a conflict, and yet they saw something that was very important at the end of that, where they saw reconciliation. They saw them kind of loving and caring for one another. What was that? Some of those students then began attending the church plant. We invited them to come to the youth group, and some of them, like Martin, began attending, and he dug into God's Word. And we were just encouraging them, look, God wants to do a work in your life from the inside out. It's not about behavioral change. It's not about how you dress, whether you drink or not. It's about whether God is working in your life, whether you're willing to allow Him to come into your life and do a work. That's what it's about. And Martin, as he was studying Scripture with us, responded to that. Over a period of several months of reading the Bible more, became a believer. Some of those students, on the other hand, came. They liked the game time. They liked the study. But they were looking for something that was like going to change them. And they just felt like, well, you know, I'm not feeling any different. This thing isn't really changing me much. And so they just stopped attending. And they kind of started, just kept doing their own thing in life. We maybe saw them later. But they were kind of like, yeah, making Jesus a part of my life, I'm not there yet. What is it that is so attractive in believers that unbelievers say, I don't know what that is, but I want a part of that. I want to experience that. Next slide, please. Could it be, possibly, that we are God's revealers and His representatives? That we are made in God's image to further reflect Him within our world and to represent Him within our relationships? We are being transformed into the image of Christ, that we are able to offer transformation to the world around us. Might it be that those Czech students saw, those who were observing in the life of our students, maybe a healing confidence that God knew all about them and at the same time loved them unconditionally? Might it be that they sensed in these students a calming assurance of God's presence, that they were chill with just, God is in my life. I'm not sure where my life is going right now, but I'm sure that God is with me, God's presence. Maybe it was a joyful acceptance or joy that came out of their lives, that God was sovereignly ruling in their lives. Friends, I'm pretty convinced that these students who were on looking witnessed and tasted the transformation that God was doing in these students' lives. Transformation. What is that word? It occurs 5 times in the New Testament. 3 times it refers to people being conformed into the image of Christ. A very familiar verse that I'm sure you're familiar with is Romans 12, 1 and 2, where it says, do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Familiar verse, metamorphosized. A verse also that you're familiar with, Romans 8, 28. All things work for the good of those who are, love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. But maybe that next verse you're not as familiar with, verse 29, where it says, for God predestined, He prearranged that His people and the circumstances around His people would cause them to be conformed, transformed into the image of Christ. It's there, folks, that we are on a path to being transformed into the image of Christ. Here's the challenge. Here's the challenge that you and I face. Each of us is on a different part of that pathway, aren't we? Some of us are at the very beginning of that pathway of being conformed to the image of Christ. There's areas of our life where there's love and joy and peace and patience. And then there's parts of our life where there's not a lot of patience, there's not a lot of love, there's not a lot of self-control. And God is working in those places to further transform us. It's kind of like, next slide, please. A Czech theologian has said this. He said that he's speaking of Czechs and their choosing to be non-believers, probably most because of their history of of there being clashes between the church and the state. And people in Europe know their history very well. And as I was saying before, the idea that Jesus, maybe I can talk about the church, that's kind of an oppressive structure that we just want to steer away from. And a Czech theologian, he says this, is that many people in Czech mistakenly consider themselves to be atheists. However, they're actually rejecting a caricature, meaning a warped view of God. He's basically saying that the people of Czech have a view of God that they say, oh, I don't like that. And yet, it's a view that's probably coming from their past understanding of history and possibly present church situation that's giving them the idea that I'm not sure I like this sort of a God. Next slide. Ed Stetzer also tells us that in the U.S., we are going in a very similar direction of more people becoming nuns, becoming those people who would say no belief. Ed Stetzer has said that the percentage of devout Christians has remained steady, while the percentage of people not practicing any religion, that part has grown. Unbelief is growing. There's a great need for spiritual transformation. Next slide. Friends, disciples of Jesus throughout the Old and New Testament are God's revealers. They're the ones who reflect Him and represent Him within all of their relationships. They are being transformed more and progressively more into the image of Christ. Where are we going with this message? Friends, I'd like to look at a very important psalm, a passage in Scripture where David describes who God is and then how David responds to who God is. I'd like to look at some characteristics of who God is that we can see. We need an alignment, a realignment of who we think God is and then how we respond to Him. You see, often we have a picture of God that comes from either the culture around us. It may come from who we think God was growing up. It may come from parental authorities in our lives of how we view who God is. And it's warped. It's distorted. And friends, this morning, and I hope not just this morning, but throughout our week, we're coming to Scripture. We're coming to God's Word to give us that realignment, to give us that confrontation of who we think God is so that we can respond to Him, we can reflect Him more in our lives. And so that's where we're going. For the next few minutes that I have, I want to look at four characteristics that David looks at of who God is in who He is as the God who is His healing knower. He is His presence. He is the one who is redeeming His mistakes. And so would you join me in just asking God, Lord, would you realign my thinking in these areas? Next slide, please. If you have your Bibles or your tablet or your phone and you want to look at Psalm 139, I'd love it if you just enjoy reading with me as I first read verses 1 through 6. David writes to the choir master, a psalm of David. Basically, he's saying, this is a psalm that I want you to sing often within your congregations. In verse 1, he says, O Lord, you have searched me, and you know me. You know when I sit down, when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before. You lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. God is our healing knower. God is the one who knows us completely and continues to love us unconditionally. You notice in these verses that six times, in six verses, David says that God knows him, understands him. For some of us, those words can be comforting to be known by God. For some of us, those words can be kind of scary. Wow, God, you know the deepest recesses of my heart? And you still are with me? You know all of the junk in my life, and you love me unconditionally because of Christ? I'm amazed at that. That word for know actually comes from the word, it's yada. And I know you've used this word many times, right? When somebody's telling you a story and you say, yeah, yada, 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 yada. Basically, you're saying, I know, I know, I know. Okay? Well, what that word literally means, though, it's not just a I know intellectually, but God says that he knows us intimately. He knows the deepest recesses of our heart and our passions that are on in our heart. This passage is telling us, is describing to us that David was healed, was touched by the knowing understanding of who God was and is in his life. As we work through these characteristics, I'm going to tell of the one characteristic, and then I want to leave you with a question that helps us to unpack that. I don't know if you have small groups, if you get together in women's groups or men's groups, but I encourage you to write down these characteristics and then the question that I'm going to follow. Travis, the next slide, please. Because I think what we want to do to unpack this is to understand that I might be able to more reflect God's character in my life, in my relationships. How can I live more authentically within my relationships as both broken and beloved? Authentically, integratedly, how can I live sincerely? How can I live on the outside like I know I am on the inside? As scary as that might be. How do I do that in my relationships? How do I do that within my workplace, within my family? Friends, David here is telling us of the healing comfort that he senses when God knows him. I think of the illustration of Peter. When Peter in Luke chapter 5 was in his boat fishing, he'd been out all night. Jesus says to him, hey, come in. I want to go into your boat. I want to teach. So he tells Peter to move back out, and he preaches. And then he says to the fisherman, he says, hey, throw your nets over the side. And Peter's response is, Master, we've been fishing all night, haven't caught a thing, but because you say so, I will. And you might remember the response, hordes of fish, to the degree that Peter realizes that was a supernatural catch of fish. And what's Peter's response? Falls down in the boat and says, Lord, go away from me because I am a sinful man. Friends, you must read the rest of the story because what happens in Peter's life is that he doesn't stay there. He doesn't stay paralyzed because of his understanding of sinfulness. Rather, he gets to know Jesus. He allows Jesus to know him so that he draws close to him. There's still a sense in Peter's life of being unholy. And yes, there's the confidence that causes him to stretch out and do things that are a little bit maybe silly sometimes. And yet Jesus is reining him back. Friends, how do we live well in knowing that we are beloved, we are loved by God, but at the same time, there's a brokenness? Because that brings authenticity. That is the transformation that is so attractive to the people around us. Let me move on. Second characteristic comes from verses 7 and following. Where shall I go from your spirit? Where shall I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the light about me be night. O Lord, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you. Friends, this is God as our securing presence. This is the God who is Emmanuel, God with us. In December, we celebrate the baby who comes, who is God Emmanuel. Just a few weeks ago, we celebrated Jesus who died, resurrected, and now is present. And in a few weeks on June 5, if this is your custom, you'll celebrate Pentecost weekend, where the Holy Spirit in the New Testament came and began to indwell his believers. God with us, God's securing presence. Look with me in the text. David says, "Where can I go?" That means nowhere. There's nowhere I can go where you are not there. "Where can I flee? Your right hand guides me. It's on me all the time." Verse 11, "In hard times, surely the darkness will hide me. But even in those times, the Father is with you." Next slide. Here's the question that I'd ask us to consider ourselves, maybe in your small groups, is this: how do I live more from a trust motivation in my Father versus a fear motivation within my relationships? How do I move from being driven by anxiety, fear, if this doesn't happen, bad things are going to happen, so I'm motivated to do that? How do I live from a sense that, "Oh, Father, you are with me in the midst of really hard discussions that I'm going to have in work this week. You're in the midst of trying to decide, what in the world am I going to do after I graduate from college? I interviewed here. I don't know where I'm going. No jobs. Lord, are you really with me?" David is saying, "Oh, he is more than just with you. He is your securing presence who goes with you." I don't know if you have been watching some of the YouTube videos that come out of Ukraine, but there is, I've been watching some of families who have been holed up in basements or sometimes their apartments, and friends, I'm just encouraged when I hang around people who are calm, who are confident that God is present with them. And friends, when I was watching these videos, there was a family that was singing a worship song. It was a song that I knew the tune of. And as I listened to it, it was like, oh my goodness, that's an English song, but they're singing it in Ukrainian. And here they are in a basement, huddled together while bombs are dropping off around them. And this is what they're singing. "He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so, he will hold me fast." It was the securing presence, it was the sense that God was with them in that basement in the midst of those bombs dropping. Friends, it was meeting for me the woman and her three children who we've been living in Chicago the last few years. I'm working on PhD studies. And so our home was open, and just in the last few months, through a series of connections, was able to find out there was a mom and three children who were leaving Ukraine and needed a place. And my Czech friend asked me, "Hey, Rich, would this work out?" And I was back in Czech a few months ago, was able to meet her, somewhat expecting to find a woman who was kind of disheveled and anxious, and her husband is still back in Ukraine. She's in Czech with her three children. And that's not what I met at all. What I met was a woman who was confident that God was in control. She was confident and concerned that her husband was in a very hard place, but that's where he needed to be in order to continue leading the flock that he had there. Friends, I need people like that around me who are demonstrating that, who are demonstrating that calm, securing presence of God in my life. Friends, I need to be that person in my wife's life, in my family's life, in my colleagues' lives. Friends, we need God's work of transformation in our lives that we can demonstrate to the world around us there is a God. Reflect for me for just a moment, would you? If we're honest with ourselves, Is it possible that our anxious reactions, the things that we become so bent out of shape about, possibly give reason to the unbelievers around us that God really doesn't have a part in our lives? Friends, it is God's presence, His securing presence, that changes us, that doesn't change the circumstances, but it makes us see them very differently. Let me move on to that third characteristic. Next slide, please. God is our sovereign designer. In verses 13, "For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, my days that were formed for me, when there was yet none of them. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I were to count them, they are more than the sand. I awake, and I am still with you." Friends, God is that person who designed us. Here, David is describing how, while still in the womb of his mother, God was forming his unshapen body. God not only formed his DNA, but he also formed the days that he would see, that David would that he would go through in his future ahead. Here's the question that I'd like to leave with you. Next question. How do people around me experience my joy in his story? You see, many of us maybe have a story behind us that has definitely impacted us, whether we realize it or not, whether we're willing to admit it or not, either positively or negatively. There's something in our lives either that has happened in the past, that's happening presently, that brings within us possibly shame, anger, fear. And joy is a hard emotion sometimes as we think back into our lives to see, God, where were you? What were you doing? And yet, this is the God who says, I have sovereignly formed you. I have set your days in the order that I want them to be. I desire that you be transformed. I desire that you be changed to trust me that I am your sovereign designer. Next slide, please. Many of you may have seen or even listened to some of his YouTube videos. Really encourage you. Nick Vujicic was a young man who grew up in Australia. Nick Vujicic, as you can see, was born without arms and legs. In fact, when he was born, they didn't have any idea that he was going to be born this way. And when he was born, the doctor took Nick and turned away and went to the back of the delivery room because he didn't want his mother to see this child that had been born. He didn't know how the mother would react. He tells of the story of his mother not receiving flowers after she had given birth because the people didn't know, do we rejoice with you? How do we respond to this child that's born in this way? Nick goes on and tells a story in some of those YouTube videos where he tells of just being ridiculed by his friends in school, not just once, but several times, considering, Lord, why have you made me this way? Maybe I just need to end my life. But then he goes on and tells the story of a family, of a mom and dad who continued to speak God's truth to him, that in spite of you being very different from the rest of the people around you, God is your sovereign designer. God is the one who has allowed you, who has been working in your life to prepare you for this path that you would walk on. Nick says, he says that right now, because of God's work in my life, you couldn't give me enough money to take a magic pill which would produce arms and legs right now. Nick tells the story of being able to say, why do I have joy? I have joy because I have confidence in a Savior who loves me so amazingly that I can be joyful for the way that he's made me. And he speaks to hundreds, thousands of people around the world. Friends, what's our takeaway from this? Okay, what I don't want you to take away is this. Man, guy born without arms and legs, my life is like so easy compared to that. What's wrong with me? Why can't I have joy? That's not what I want you to take away from that, because what that does, that puts you in the on the track of the gerbil, the hamster wheel of comparison. When I compare myself to other people, instead of asking God, God, who have you made me? What do you think of me? How do you hold my future in your hands? That's the point I want you to take away from this, friends. That's the point in my question is saying, how do people experience the joy from my life in his story, the story that he's made out of my life? Because God is our person who is our sovereign designer. Let me hurry on to that last point. God is our restoring redeemer. In the last part, this is a part of the chapter. I don't know if you've read Psalm 139, but these are the verses that always give me a little bit of a question mark, because I wonder, holy cow, did someone just like stick these on at the end? Because everything is really nice telling about God. And then we run into verses 19 to 24 where it says, oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God. O men of blood, depart from me. They speak against you with malicious intent. Your enemies make your name in vain, take your name in vain. Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with complete hatred. I count them my enemies. And then in verse 23, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, know my thoughts. See if there's any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Friends, David was a truth speaker and a truth liver. My best understanding of how to interpret these verses within the rest of the context is when I look at the first part where it says, of the psalm, where it says, God, you have known me. You know me very well. And now I'm convinced that David is stopping and saying, yes, it may be true that these people are against you, God. You don't like them. I don't like them. I have a hard time getting along with them. And David stops. And he says, but Lord, would you test my heart? Would you see my anxious ways? Would you help me to be one who lives a life that is life-giving? You see, many times we may be true speakers. We may win the battle, but friends, we too often lose the war in our battles with people that we have political differences with, moral differences with. What is the issue of family and life and marriage? Yes, we may be diametrically opposed to them. And we do need to speak truth. What I'm asking us to consider is, how does God want to transform us that we become true speakers and at the same time aware of how our words have an impact upon them? And that's the question I want to leave us with here. In which of my relationships is God inviting me to reflect more of him as a restoring redeemer, as one who is able to redeem even my dumb mistakes of the past? In the places in my relationships where I've been hurtful, where I've been, I may have said something that was true, but maybe I said it in a way that just wasn't helpful. A few years ago, I remember this so vividly. Susan and I were trying to decide something, and we weren't coming to a conclusion. And I said something that was probably true, and that was the way that it needed to be. And I went to my office, or I think to the bedroom, and Susan, a few minutes later, came in and said, you know, Rich, that was really hurtful how you said that. Not what I said, but how I said that. And friends, this was a God thing. It was as if God just gave me the grace to not defend, to not say, well, that's the way it needed to be, to just listen, all right? I count that as one of those, you know, really cool times in Rich's life where God just grabbed me by the shoulders and said, Rich, just listen, would you? Because you need to hear something. And I just remember God just saying, just causing me to say, just listen, Rich. Just respond with, thank you. Thank you. I need to consider that. I'm not ready to deal with that right now, but let's return to that. And we did. And during that time, the Lord just working in my heart, yeah, Rich, you may have said the right thing, the truthful thing, but the way you said it was demeaning to this person who is a daughter of the Father of Heaven. Grateful, not for the hard times that God transforms us, but grateful that He chooses to continue transforming me to be more like Him, a redeeming Savior. Let me just finish with a few points. Next slide, please. Where do we go with this? What's the what of or the how of transformation? Friends, transformation does not happen unless we are a follower of Jesus. Transformation into the image of Jesus begins when there's new life, when we have gone from death, as Ephesians 2 tells us, and we've been brought into life, where there is a reception of the grace of the righteousness that God offers us through Jesus, and we say, I need you. And thank you, Jesus, that you took my sin and you gave me your righteousness because I am not right. That's the time that transformation can begin in our lives. Next slide. And please, friends, let's not despise the small beginnings of God's transformational work in my life, the little steps that God is doing in my life. Jesus talked so many times about the mustard seed that grew into a huge bush. He talked about leaven of kingdom that started and had a working in the whole dough. Jesus did not despise small beginnings. Don't despise that in your life. Encourage the people around you. Next slide. And friends, transformation takes place in community. Community is the crucible. It's the place where it gets mixed up and ground up, and then there's something beautiful that comes out of that transformation. Just encouraging you, whether that's women's groups, it's men's groups, whether that's an accountability group, a Bible study, friends, that's where we are being challenged to hear God's word afresh again and then be able to work that out with our friends, with our relatives who really love us and care for us. Friends, today is an opportunity to step again into that transformation process. It takes courage. It takes daily denying self, taking up my cross, and following after Jesus to continue stepping into His transformation process. But friends, there's joy in that. There's a lot of fruit, not just for us. There's a lot of fruit for the people around us, in our families, our spouses, the people at work, the people in our schools. Just challenging you, submit, follow God in His work that He wants to do in your life. Amen. Just ask the worship team. I know they're going to be leading us in a couple praise songs. As you're coming, let me just pray and ask God to bless His word. Lord, I thank you that your word is, for many of us, a comfort. It's an encouragement. It's a salve that heals the places that we need to be healed in, that touch those places that need touching. And Lord, thank you that your word for us is like a hammer many times where we need to change. We need to bow to you. We need to submit to you. And so would you have freedom in each of my sisters and brothers here to do your work of transformation, to do your work of using your word to change their minds and hearts. In my life, I pray as well, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Please stand with us as we close with some worship. Riches I eat not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure. cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. He shall return in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Oh, praise the
we show our appreciation for what the Lord has done for us. Let's praise him. Thanks to our worship team, and also thanks to Pastor Rich for bringing God's word to us this morning. I'm going to allow them to excuse themselves, and Donna, through the side door because they actually have a table out in the lobby. If you go out the lobby and turn left, information on Ukraine, information on their ministry, you're more than invited to do that. But at 11:05 in the library, they're going to give you some more information about their ministry, and we're going to make sure that that's done by 11:35. Now to him who is able to protect you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his own glory without blemish and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory and majesty and power and authority and dominion before all time, right now, and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please greet one another as you leave, but you are dismissed at this time. Thanks for being here this morning. We appreciate that.